ইন দ্য সেকেন্ড সেশন অফ দ্য ওয়েবিনার আফটার
আর
লাঞ্চ।
একবার বলুন, আর একবার বলুন।
হ্যাঁ, স্টার্ট করি?
ইয়েস, লেটস স্টার্ট।
থ্যাংক ইউ। গুড আফটারনুন অ্যান্ড আই ওয়েলকাম অল অফ ইউ ইন দ্য সেকেন্ড সেশন অফ দিস ওয়েবিনার আফটার লাঞ্চ। অ্যান্ড আই হোপ দ্যাট ইউ হ্যাভ এনজয়েড ইউর লাঞ্চ স্টেইং অ্যাট হোম। অ্যান্ড নাও আই রিকোয়েস্ট ডক্টর ইন্দ্রমোহন মণ্ডল, প্রিন্সিপাল অফ শ্রী চৈতন্য কলেজ হাবড়া, for his welcome address in this second session. Sir, please, the screen is over.
Dr. Mondol, please be live. ইন্দ্রবাবু বলুন। হ্যাঁ, হ্যালো। এটা দরকার নেই, তুমি ডক্টর দাসকে তুমি বলে দাও, উনি বলুন। ছেড়ে দাও না, তুমি স্যারকে লাইভে নিয়ে চলে আসবে, তুমি বাবুকে লাইভে গ্রুপ করে শুভকটা করে। There is some technical problem with Dr. Mondol. So Dr. Okay. Das, you can proceed and introduce Dr. Satpathy to continue the session, please.
Thank you, sir. Let me introduce Professor Lakshmiran Satpathy, the speaker of the second session. Dr. Satpathy is presently being as the professor of the geography and director of the UGC Human Resource Development Center, University of Calcutta, and the area of interest in specialization in the climatology, geomorphology, hydrology, and quantitative geography. Dr. Satpathy passed his master's degree in the University of Calcutta and the specialization of the meteorology and advanced climatology. And joined in the Lal Baba College, University of Calcutta in 1999, and later completed his PhD degree in University of Calcutta in 2002, and later joined in the University of Calcutta Department of Geography in 2006, and he has been the professor of the Department of Geography in University of Calcutta in 2014. And his area of research interest is the climate, water resources, geoforms, population, environment and development, and particular development and capacity building in geography. And he has already supervised 12 scholars for awarding the PhD degrees and 10 scholars in MPhil degrees. And presently is mentoring one postdoctoral fellow, Radhakrishnan Fellowship, in and ICSSR fellow pursuing in the degrees. And he has been the author of 5 books in reputed publishing houses in the international arena, and published more than 30 articles in reputed journals in international level. And he has delivered more than 50 invited lectures in national and international level, and the seminar and conferences. and he has been awarded as the National Scholar in 1995 and INSA Travel Grant in 2012 for IGU conference in Germany. He is member of different important committees in the universities around the country, with different universities, and he is in the famed in the academic field, and he has been the chairman of the High Power Committee to evaluate manpower restructuring the NACMO 2018-19, and presently is being the editor of the Indian Journal of Landscape System and Ecological Studies of Indian Institute of Landscape Ecology and Aesthetics, Kolkata. Now, sir, with this family, sir, like you, we are energetic, and we are feminine enough. And I request you, sir, for your deliberation. Sir, please share your screen. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Das. So I am really grateful to the two colleges, Bhairav Ganguly College and Sri Chaitanya College, the honorable principals and vice principals, and all the faculty members and other members of the institution, the students also, and our esteemed colleagues who have joined to listen to me. I am really fortunate to be with them all. So now we are passing through a great problem, and a never before problem, I can say, with regard to the novel coronavirus disease 2019. So all the sectors of society, economy, and polity, they have been very much affected by this COVID-19. But our concern will be now on the education sector. Particularly today, we are going to discuss some of the issues relating to higher education institutions, with particular reference to India, and what we are really going to have in terms of its demands, and also what kind of strategies that we can adopt in the future or near future. So whether it is going to be ad hoc or going to be a permanent solutions. So let us explore what we have in our arsenal and what we can further develop. So the context is this COVID-19 for the last about 6 months. So almost all the countries, some way or other, at some point of time, they were completely locked down, and still lockdown period is going on. And God knows that how far this lockdown period will continue. And it has a cascading effect on both society, economy, and polity that I have already told. This is for the first time that more than 7 billion plus, that is the entire population of the earth, that has been confined to some extent or to a great extent, so that there can be the physical distancing, and that can flatten the curve, or it can just wipe out the disease in the long run. So vaccine, it has not yet come. And we rather don't see that immediately there will be availability of any panacea or a cure system that will completely make this corona virus free of the world. And this is particularly so because the strains are coming in a newer format. So the same vaccines may not work. And this will be really difficult for humankind to go back to our business as usual. Rather, if this newer strains comes, and given the SARS, MERS, and Ebola-like diseases, so the physical interactions we have to lessen, reduce to some extent, so our development strategies will be definitely different from our so-called physical contact-based to communication-based. And one very good example is this webinar that we are now under the compulsion we are organizing, the technology was there very much some few years back, and the technology is growing very fast with this wave 1.0, wave 2.0, like this. We are going to discuss all these things. And you know that the driver of economic growth was earlier these fuels like the petroleums and all that, but now it is the data and information that is going to be the driver of economic growth and also human development, that the pundits globally, they are the thinkers, they are actually pondering their thoughts on this. Now, if we go back to our four industrial revolutions, actually why these industrial revolutions discussion is important, you know that with the industrial revolutions, the human society has taken its shapes and it has been reshaped. The demands of the societies were created and the demands were met through the supplies. So with the first industrial revolution since 1784, the agriculture revolution, and after that the first industrial revolution, this the fuel was water and steam. Then mechanized production came and there was huge production systems and supply and price got down, so profits were there. And the second wave it came in 1870s with the electrical power, so mass production was a reality and everyone, a high consuming society was founded with this industrial revolution 2.0. Then the third industrial revolution, it came with the automation. It was not the digital, it was analog also, but since 1970s, the digital platforms were also coming through with the computer technology, information communication technology. And then after, it is not, it cannot be fixed that it is the 2010, but around 2010, this automation and data exchange through huge digitalization, it has come to the fore. So the world is changing very fast with the technology, and the digital technology, information communication technology, they are coming in all the spheres of life. Now, with these industrial revolutions, they are not just isolated something. They are very much linked to the waves of innovations. So with the industrial demands, the social demands, economic and political demands, definitely there are the waves of innovations. And if we see that so far, almost six waves of innovations have taken place. And the first innovation was this iron and water power, mechanization, textile, all that. The second one was the steam power, then third with the electrical, fourth, the petrochemicals and electronics. Then the fifth, the digital networks and biotechnology software development. And the sixth, the sustainability issues with the radical resource productions, biomimicry, then green chemistry, industrial ecology, renewable. We are thinking about that the non-renewables will be reduced and the renewables will come. And this red curve is very important, that accordingly we have to design and redesign our curricula and prepare our students who are the leaders of the society in future. So innovations and human resource development, they go hand in hand. Again, if we see that how the human population has grown for the last about 11,000 years, then you can see that with the industrial revolutions, the mass production systems, then food security and technological developments, exploitation of resources, that has given less mortality, and definitely the result is the huge population net growth, and we are now around 7.5 billion population throughout the globe. And this has been possible because of all these technological developments throughout the world. Now, with this novel coronavirus disease 19, it is not that corona is the responsible, but corona has revealed the situation very much. Many of these were under the carpet, but now they have come out. So the virus has come to some way or other. We are not going into the debate how it has originated, but the result is very important, that it is a highly infectious disease. We have to be quarantined, and the mortality and morbidity is going high with this, because the mortality issue with the comorbid situations and with the lockdown, there are this morbidity function is also going up by some kind of deprivation in food security and impoverishment of a large section of the population. And healthcare facility is also not up to the mark, and it has already been exposed throughout the world that the WHO is also almost helpless, and the IMF has designated it as a great lockdown with this trade loss, job loss, displacements, and there are some stimulus packages have to be given by the governments, but that is going to take toll on the exchequers and the government revenue. Definitely the resources will not be available in future for our traditional allocations, like the funds that we used to get earlier in our education sector, or particularly the higher education sector. If the GDP allocation was 1.6, I don't know whether in the next 2-3 years these GDP allocations will be 1.6 or 2%. It will definitely come down to 1%, because the growth rate is going to be almost zero, or if not, then within less than 1%, what was earlier around 5% or 6%. So the estimated loss is really huge. It is due to the corona itself. And there are a lot of things going on. But more importantly, manual labor is going to be replaced by artificial intelligence. Yes?
Sir, if you kindly increase your audio, is there any option to increase your audio?
No. Let me see. I have to be a little bit louder. Okay, so.
Okay, sir.
So can you now hear me?
Yes. It's better. Or you can subpost to the audio, okay?
Okay. So it is a break in the social capital formation. You know that a human resource development is also a kind of capital resource formation. And if the situation, physical contact is the barrier, then definitely artificial intelligence and robotics will play a greater role. And finally, the human resources will be definitely in a disadvantaged position, particularly in our countries where the human population and the labor supply is more.
Sir, is there any option to increase your laptop volume? Laptop volume you can increase.
Laptop volume, yes. Let me see. Yes, is it? Now?
Yes, now? It is better than earlier.
Okay. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Okay.
So now let us go back to our education scenario. In 1964, this Kothari Commission, this is a comprehensive national education policy came, and now another education policy is going to come up. But we again and again we go back to this Kothari Commission report. This is the fundamental or base, like our fundamental. The preambles of our Indian constitution, this is more or like this. So what is there? This destiny of India is now being set in her classrooms. Now in this corona, the very much classroom concept is going to change. So far we know that this classroom means a classroom within the four walls, in a college, in a physical setup. But how these classrooms are going to be changed, so it is a very, very big issue under this corona. The second issue is that it is based on science and technology. So science is always there in the nature itself. Whatever we, the human beings, have learned or explored from the nature, it is the science. So science is already there in the nature itself. So it is the technology which is humans only. And we, but technology is definitely other creatures, they also use the technology. But human beings are the master of technology, and education technology particularly, it has come to our rescue under this classroom paradigm shift in classroom environment. And then it is the level of prosperity, welfare, and security of the people that is also linked to our classrooms. Because if our students are engaged with new ideas and they have a very good capacity building, definitely they are going to lead our nations in a productive way. So this preamble is should be taken into very seriously and kept in our heart. Now, this is a general view of our is not only our, but in entire world, the higher education architecture. It starts with curricula and pedagogy, and it ends with the leadership or governance. And the other areas are faculty, research, partnership, infrastructure, and funding. So Corona is going to affect all these, everything. We are not going to discuss all these issues. We can discuss these in the question answer sessions if time permits, or if the suitable questions comes. So this is the stakeholders in higher education institutions, be it a college or a university or any standalone institutions. So first of all, it is the management or the promoters of the institutions, maybe in the private sector or public sector, or maybe in the joint venture, whatever it may be. So they are going to recruit the administrative staffs, then the faculty members. Everyone has a very good role to play. Then for the students, definitely, and the students must be employable. So there must be the employers in the society, and the parents, they are also very much benefited by the students, and the community at large, and finally the alumni. The students, they are going to be alumni, and everyone has a very good stake in the higher education systems. And we can say all these things a little bit later. So coming back to India, the education sector is in the federal list, so in the concurrent list, and the constitution has of India has given it. So the in the apex there is this CAB, or Central Advisory Board on Education. It sits for its meeting very irregularly. Nowadays, we cannot see any role of these. So the Ministry of Human Resource Development, that is there, and we are now very much, its presence we feel through the RUSHA and all other projects. So even in the UGC letterhead also, you can find mention of MHRD, good or bad, that we can discuss later on. So UGC, it's said to be an autonomous organization under the Act of the Parliament, but MHRD is right now controlling very much. So UGC, AICT for the technical educations, National Council for Teacher Education for the teachers training, and NAC, we all know it started its journey since late 80s and 90s, particularly. Now NAC grading is very much linked to this RUSHA. So now these are all, everyone, we know it. At the state level also, State Higher Education Council, then Higher Education Department, they also take care of almost everything. Then the universities with the constituting colleges, university college or the departments, and other state, these standalone institutions like IIT, IIM, ISC and all that. So this is not for the experienced faculty members who have joined, but for those who are the newly recruits, they are going to be exposed to this higher education structure. Unless we know this, it is not going to be helpful for them also. That's why I am trying to highlight all these. So autonomous college may be there, and affiliated colleges, and most of our concern is this affiliated colleges. Today we are also going to discuss mostly with these affiliated colleges where teaching and administrative departments are there. And among the affiliated colleges, definitely this can be government colleges, the aided or sponsored, or the private colleges. Again, the universities can be central, state, or private, or deemed. Although these deemed university concepts, the UGC is going to discontinue the deemed universities, and there can be the open universities, unitary universities, affiliating universities. Some of the online universities are also coming. They may not have the recognition, or some of them they have the recognitions. The directorates of distance education are also attached to some of the universities. Then there can be many types of specialized universities also, like agriculture, law, sports, petroleum, and many others. So in India, the higher education is highly pluralistic and a very diversified field. We cannot give a single prescription for all of them. So that is my main issue, that wherever the demand should be definitely different in different types of institutions. Now, if we have a relook in the revised NAC accreditation framework, then you can find why I am telling all these. You can find it later on. That the process is the self-study report submission, then the student satisfaction survey, and the team visit and its report. And it has a quantitative matrices and qualitative metrics. And there are 7 criteria, 32 indicators, and then in total 121 matrices are there. But we are going to see that if we go to the digital platform, then how it is possible to address the indicators. Now, suppose this curriculum aspect, then there are these 4 key indicators, then you can find that it is possible. And in the feedback system also, we can have the feedback. If you see that when the enrollment is taking place, it is digital. So if it is the feedback by the students and on the curriculum also, it can be done. So accordingly, the teaching, learning, and evaluation platforms, the platforms are available. So that we have discussed, going to discuss a little bit later. Then research, innovation, and extensions, to some extent, this can be promoted, and to some extent, this cannot be done. So physical and virtual world, whether and how much they can be mixed, or if there is any kind of conflict, that is the issue. So infrastructure, physical infrastructure development, it requires huge amount of money and the funds, and maintenance is again a very great difficulty. Suppose in our tropical environment, if you construct a building, after 5 years, it has to be maintained, and the depreciation cost is no less than 10% to 20%. So student support and progression, alumni contacts and engagements, that can be done digitally also. Then the governance issue, leadership management, how far this can be done, we're going to discuss. Then this institutional values and best practices, these are some of the statements and some of the works that we usually do that makes the institutions distinct from one to the another. So the role, the goals and missions are stated, and whether these are achieved through what way, so that is the distinctiveness for each and everyone. Now, what's new? You can see this explicit paradigm shift, making it ICT enabled. So this is very important, because 70% of your submission, the documents are under this DVV, digital validation and verification, and 30% is this peer visit. And again, this peer visit report, that is also submitted online. That means now whatever publications we have done, they are going to confirm it from the third party. And in this third party are some of the journal houses and the publication websites. That means the physical contact is now being abolished or gradually phased out. So in the NAC exercise itself, there is a huge scope given to this online phenomena. Now let us review what the government of India, or rather it is not that government of India means one particular political government. Government is government. So be it a Congress or UPA or a BJP or NDA, whatever, or in the coming days, another type of governments. So it is a kind of compulsion, and it has been taking place through a global networking or global demand. Otherwise, we are going to be isolated. So since the opening up of our Indian economy in 1990s, then all these things were there. So we have to open up, and we have to build our own capacity. So the Digital India, the 9 pillars, they are already functioning, and in many platforms we are using it rather. So our concern is not all these, but we have to concentrate on our education sector alone. So this national mission on education using ICT, what the India is going to look, these are all the apps are on, thousands and thousands of apps are coming, both from the government sector and also from other sectors, and we are using it knowingly or unknowingly. But in the back end, there are certain operators, the certain controlling authorities, they are there. So this national mission on education, information and communication technology, this is under this Ministry of Human Resource Development to address the education, learning, and related needs. It is not confined within this higher education institutions also. The other needs of the teachers and for the lifelong learners. So learning should not stop for the teachers also. Suppose we learn for 25 years. It is not exactly 25 years. Formally, after 5 years, we join, and 20 years we are actively in learning. Then we enter into service. So if then at the age of 25 years, we join the service in the college teacher, then we are going to stay for another 40 years. So is it possible that we can stay with our learning of 25 years for the next 40 years? It is not at all possible. With the changes in the technology, demand of the society, and the industrial revolutions, all that. So we have to change, you know, change the mindsets, change our the techniques, the tools, and the way of learning. So every day, a lot of things are coming we have to learn. So earlier it was the mathematics we had to learn. We have to learn the communication, the English language. So some of our students from the villages, when they come to any urban area to attend a class, if the classes are in English medium, so they find it very difficult to cope with. So similarly, technology is also a very big question mark for not only for those rural disadvantaged population, but also our older generation populations. Suppose a person may be using Victorian English, but he may be very bad in using the Android phone. So we have to see these as the skill sets. So skills and knowledges are quite different. So knowledges and learnings and the wisdoms, they are completely different from these kinds of skill sets. So these are simple skills we have to learn if we have to stay in our profession. Now this national mission on education through ICT, you can see that empowerment, its tagline is very important. Empowerment of students and teachers through synchronous and asynchronous instruction. So synchronous means at a time, asynchronous, it can be anywhere. Have different types of advantages and disadvantages, definitely, but the options are there. Now this, these are some of the key issues. Providing access. So in our national education policies, every time we talk about this access, equity, quality management and all that. So how this ICT-based national mission of education that can cater to the needs. You can see everything is there. So provide access, access is there, quality assessment, then bridging the digital divide. We are talking about this digital divide, but it is already there. So the government and the policymakers, they have already thought of it that there should be the bridging the gaps. And definitely, if this physical distancing is going to be the norms of the society, definitely the technology will come and the huge subsidies will be, the, or rather cross subsidies will be given. Suppose the maintenance cost in the physical infrastructures, that is huge. To establish a university or a college, its buildings and all that, that will provide all the digital phones and network connectivity for next 5 years. So if we use these digital platforms and maintaining the less physical infrastructure, definitely that can be an issue. But again, if it is necessitated, otherwise this sudden jump is not always welcome. Many people, they cannot cope with this sudden change. So if the change is a phased manner, it is a slower process, definitely the society can adopt the technology also in the long run. So what can be adopted by the year 2030? Definitely it cannot be, everything cannot be changed by the year 2030. So training the trainers is very important. Training the trainers, providing equity, provide connectivity, empower the teachers and learners. This is very important. And the question of autonomy will come. We can discuss it if the question answers permit. And e-learning. So this is a platform. There are many platforms definitely available and coming up also. Now, again, if you go to this national mission, you can find already certain apps or platforms have already been developed. They showed Sindhu, Vidwan, then virtual labs, spoken tutorials, and all that. I am coming to this. Yes. If this Shodha Shuddhi, plagiarism is a big issue. Earlier in the physical format, suppose I publish a journal in a physical format, and it has been published some 30 years back, and the same thing I am going to publish in a lesser known journal. So that is very easy to copy. The plagiarism of any sort, it may be copying from others, copying from the others' ideas, or the self-plagiarism, everything can be checked in these days. And since knowledge is a proprietary resource and can be patented, so this plagiarism detection is very, very important. And UGC has given that in even in the thesis, the plagiarism should not be less than 10%. And there is a zero tolerance against plagiarism, and it has become a mantra throughout the world, because knowledge has become a driver of economy, and knowledge is a sellable product in the market. So earlier it was not possible, but now with this TRIPS, it is possible. So in the GATT, this was very much there. Then Vidwan is the expert database on National Research Network. So you can see that this GAN program and many other programs that are coming in. So this networking can be done. So, and I have given all the URLs, you can find it. Then virtual laboratory. So laboratory is a question, and many of our teachers and our higher education administrators, they are always anxious about how the laboratory will, experiments will take place. Maybe in some of the laboratories, like say chemistry laboratory or physical education laboratory, you may not be able to do that to the full extent, but to some extent definitely it can be done. And by virtual laboratory, can you imagine that how many our creatures are saved? So earlier the frogs were dissected to see the anatomy, and it is the human anatomy, and frogs, the digestive systems, they are very similar. So thousands and millions of frogs were earlier had to be killed, but now we can very finally simulate the virtual laboratory experiments, even in some many others, in the mathematics, in statistics, in computer science. They are virtual laboratories are the basic laboratories. Even in the biological sciences, in the geosciences also, the virtual laboratories, they can do wonder, and only a very minor person, maybe it can be from 0 to 30 to 50% of verification has to be done physically. So virtual laboratories are wonder, and this has become possible with the technological revolutions. Then this spoken tutorial, the communication is very important. We know many things, our students know many things, but they cannot communicate is very clearly. That's why they are unemployable. Otherwise, this employment issue can be raised from less than 10% to definitely 15 to 20%. Then this free or LIBOR. LIBOR means free open source software for education. So this can be proprietary or branded or open, like say Ubuntu, in almost all application softwares also, and also these the softwares which are the fundamental softwares. So they both of them are nowadays available for free use, and they are also developing it under open licensing systems. Then eJantro, it is not concerned for our general education, but eJournals, eShodha Sindhu, eJournals are available, thousands. And even if you see these open access journals like Duaz, or open access books like Duab, so they are also very much available. And in India also, the government of India has given this eShodha Sindhu portal, and if you use it with this NDL, National Digital Laboratory, so huge millions of e-contents are available. Then Shodh Ganga, the theses are now uploaded, and this has given access to the researchers that what has already been studied and where from I can start. This is one issue. And secondly, whether there is any kind of plagiarism, anybody can see what was the thesis. Earlier it was not possible. So in our confined classrooms or confined research laboratories, we can hide our research. But now it has to be open, and anybody can see what is the outcome of the research. So funding, if it is related to outcome, then this should be a ratio between the outcome and the investment. And if the ratio is higher than one, definitely it is profitable for the society. It may not be that quantitatively always the profit should be business minded, but corporate mindset with a public heart for the good of the people, this should be always welcome. So then there are these e-Pathshala, gateway for e-books, up to PG level, you can find it. Then Swayam Prabha through the television networks. Many of our students, they are using it under compulsion. But if it is not compulsory, then definitely we are not using it. Then this is the Swayam platform. The study way for active and young mind. It is thousands of course curriculums are available, and they are designed, prepared, and uploaded by the faculty members in the universities and colleges. The quality check has been done by the peer review system, and it has been uploaded with the credit system. and these are absolutely free, and the credits are transferable. So, and in the UGC curriculum framework also, the universities have been given the choice to frame the curriculum, so there can be around 30% this choice based, where it can be taken from the SWAM also. So if under this lockdown period the students were given, or rather in future they are given the opportunity that you can bring the 30% around from your SWAM platform, then that will be added to the overall credit instead of this. This is ad hoc, definitely. We have to appreciate that there is no other way, that the government is also thinking very hard. The universities are under compulsion that in the fourth semester they have to conduct the examination, but it is not possible in the physical system, and we could not take the measures earlier also. That's why this 50-50 ratio has already been taken, rather the decisions have been taken. Maybe these are going to be implemented very soon. But if in future this transferable credit systems have also been adopted, then that will definitely give some good for the students, for the administration also. And this Samarth platform, this is the university administration portal. How best we can administer the institutions with the database, the fund management, the student management, the employee management, and we can see the changes, that how far the achievements have taken place from earlier to New York. So accordingly, we can allocate the human resources and physical and monetary resources. Now, this is very important, although this is a kind of US standard and this is highly debatable also, but to some extent, this is operation. Sociologists, psychologists, the political thinkers, the economists, the literators, they differ a lot in the concept of generations and fixing the generations also. But there are some common consensus also. So in the US style, if you see, those who were born during 1940s till 1960s, they are the baby boomers. So after the recession in the post-war period, there was a growing profit society, so high consumption, all that. So there was a peace everywhere. So the traditional prosperous society developed, and that's why the gold rush, the job opportunity was created in the US. Then came this generation X, Y, Z, with the technological changes. That is the highlight. Mostly, if you see the generation X, those who were born in 1970, before 1980, so we are that generation. We experienced that MTV was new to us, so Facebook was new to us. Although Facebook, it has come later on to us, but in the Western world, it came much earlier. Then the internet, the Netflix, then mobile devices, and this generation who are now taking place, that the birth taking place, maybe the entirely different situation will come when the graphics will take place, the alphabets. So the world will see the kind of a common language. Even in these days we are using in the WhatsApp or in the Facebook messengers, or like that, different kinds of emojis. So emojis are universal languages. So it is a kind of a new thing. So the world is very changing. Now suppose if I belong to the category of the first generation X, and now I have to deal with the generation Z or generation Wi-Fi, this iGen generation or generation Wi-Fi or post-millennial, so I will be in a difficult situation. I have to appreciate their demands, their skills, and I have to remain one step ahead of them. Otherwise, I cannot handle them in the classroom situations, be it in the physical classroom or they eat in the virtual classrooms. So controlling doesn't mean that political control. Political controls are nothing. So ultimately, it is the control of our respect to them and the control of dignity in both ways. So now, under this COVID or in COVID, that means if COVID continues, and in post-COVID situation, if COVID is non-existent. So what can be our adaptation strategies for the future or near future? Now, given the situation scenario that we have already discussed, we have to revisit our relevance. So whether for the last 3 months, since March, our physical existence of the buildings and administrations and all that, they are almost non-existent. So whatever presence that we are trying to fill among our students through a networked or virtual world. So we have to revisit that if the situation doesn't change in future and COVID or COVID-like diseases continued in future, we have to prove in the society that why we are for. And for that, we have to revisit our infrastructure facilities, that how it can change. Then repurposing. For what purpose we are here? We have to engage our students for a productive, gainful employment and a capacity building for them so that they can be prepared themselves to take the charge of the social functions in different sectors of the economy and society, be it from economy or politics, or maybe in any kind of job or mercantile. So we have to revalidate the components. The components means we can take these from the stakeholders' point of view, from the manager's point of view, the promoter's point of view, or maybe from various departments of or the components of the institutions, be it a college or the university. So we have to revalidate that whether whatever we have, are these functionable, or we have to change to make them functionable. Then to engage the students for effective outcome. Earlier, students used to come to us. So demand is more, supply is less. That's why during the admission, there is a craze for students' enrollment or enlistment or admission. But again, you can find that in many of the engineering colleges or many of the streams in the general colleges or many colleges also, they are not finding the students. So where are these students going? Are they deliberately dropping? Or is it that the education cost has gone up? So there can be many types. And if the students have to come to the college, they have to forego two types of costs. They are involves two types of costs. One cost is that they have to come, and for that they have to spend something in terms of their transport, their tiffin and all that, so some pocket money. But at the same time, those students who are 18 plus, so they could otherwise be employed, many of them, under the our economic situation in our country or the developing countries. So they have to forgo their job. So one side is the employment opportunity, another side their cost involved for physical presence in the class. So if they don't remain present, we deduct their marks. So it is a very, very crucial question. Now, under this situation, the students are not coming. So what we have to do? We have to reach to them. Now the cost involved. Suppose if they have to come to the colleges for 75% attendance and the cost involved in a year, then how much is saved in this way? Is it not sufficient for purchasing an Android phone and to have connectivity? So we have to think in different way also. We have to change our mindset and think out of box from our traditional way of thinking, in the way that we were taught to think. Rather, we have to be agile to think in a different manner for situational thinking. So, whether under the new scenario or the changeover, the access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability is being maintained. So far, our revisit to the NAC frameworks or the Government of India initiatives, then it is possible. So ICT is going to play a very, very big role, and this digital divide, the question answer, if I have to find, definitely at this point I can say it can be a judicial mix, but future is definitely towards digital. So towards digital is very, very important. Then there is a paradigm shift in the learning environment from our physical structure or infrastructure to this go digital. So it is our go digital mentality that we have to cultivate if even the situation improves. Now, one question comes. The COVID was not there in 1990s. It was not there in 2015. So when our economy was opened up, our technology was opened up, when our knowledge become resource, it becomes sellable, it become proprietary resource, and the digital platforms were created in 2015, it was definitely not to see that a coronavirus is going to affect us by 2020 and we have to build our infrastructure today. Slowly, these are inevitable and we have to take these platforms gradually. So Corona has accelerated the movement. Now, the autonomy. This is a very $1 billion question. So autonomy of thinking and autonomy of acting. But many times we don't have the autonomy at the student's learning level or teachers' imparting level or institutions managerial level and everywhere. So how to ensure the autonomy in a controlled system and to embrace the autonomy in a market system? So under the patronage and under the demand of the market. So there are two different situations. So in this balance, how to balance the autonomy, this again we have to revisit and repurpose. Now these are some of the scenarios where online teaching, the blended teaching and face-to-face teaching. You can see that definitely these have some advantages and disadvantages, but online teaching is not just like our face-to-face teaching. It was in some cases one-way teaching, sometimes it is two-way teaching. If we don't allow the students to encourage or to raise questions, sometimes it happens that sage on stage. So whatever a teacher, because the teacher had some marks in attendance, some marks in evaluation, and some authority or control over the students, so out of fear, they may not question a teacher. Similarly, a teacher may not disturb a student due to many other compulsions. So sometimes that is not comfortable. So even in the face-to-face teaching learning environment, a good relation is not there. What we are anxious about that in the online system, they will be completely removed. In a learning management system is a holistic system. It is not just like our Zoom or Google Meet or Google Classroom like that. Google Classroom is definitely one step ahead. Just like Moodle, it is like this. Or in Swayam, it is also a learning management system. So there, all four quadrants from this text, the content delivery of text or videographics, then there can be the progress evaluation and the discussion forums. Everything can be done in the virtual conference also. So face-to-face learning can go to from regular to PCP model, so personal contact model. And under this use of Wave 2.0 tools, where it is a dynamic, so two-way process, even in our Facebooks, in our Messenger services, or in our WhatsApp services, we used to do it. And technology in future will permit us to do many of these things. So I am very much optimistic that face-to-face is definitely required, but we can go for a blended kind of learning environment right today. So finally, let us conclude with these words that every day begins with a new challenge, whether there is COVID or no COVID. Challenges can be made opportunities, because unless there is challenge, humanity will not move forward. Opportunities come through relearning. So whatever we have learned, we must unlearn. Even Einstein's theories, the laws are now challenged. So if they are not challenged, even God is challenged. If we don't challenge, definitely the learning will not proceed. So the curriculum has to be challenged. The teachers have to be challenged. Students have to be challenged. Our knowledge, we have to challenge ourselves that whatever I was yesterday, what I am today, and what I am going to be tomorrow. That is very, very important. And relearning is the key to sustenance. And sustenance sustain the humanity. With these words, let me thank you. Thank you very much. So I have ended my discussion. Thank you. Is there anybody? Hello.
Hello. যারা যারা আমরা আমরা তাহলে যারা গিফট দিচ্ছি যারা যারা পার্টিসিপেট করেছে সবাইকে আমরা পার্টিসিপেট
Yes, so I have finished my deliberation.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Shatpati, for your nice presentation. And at the end, we have some questions over to you.
Sure, sure.
So the first question is this is very common also. We all know that ICT is the only tools and technologies to communicate with this problem for the pandemic or over pandemic situation. So if you think COVID-19 has changed the work pattern of the higher education institution, engaging all over our creativity. So what would you like to keep from the new ways of working, apart from ICTs and other, do you think?
Yes, so in the corona environment, two things are important. One is this physical distancing has to be maintained. So the technology in the information communication systems, that is inevitable. There is no substitute. But a mixing of physical distancing can be done. Suppose the teachers, if they can do with the physical distancing, they can work in the laboratories in the various shifts. So crowding has to be, or overcrowding has to be minimized.
Exactly.
That means in a class of 30, we can reduce it by 10, 10, 10, and accordingly in three shifts or three different slots, we can ensure that instead of the complete absence, we can ensure to some extent personal contacts under certain shifts. And surely this digital platforms has to be more active. It is not that just through email or just through WhatsApp, because they have some limitations. We have to learn how to use the other better learning platforms like Moodle or Google Classroom. So if everyone go for the Google Classroom, or some, if we can purchase some of the softwares also, like say Zoom and all that, or some other platforms are also there, even some indigenous platforms are also coming in. So blended mode is the best mode, always.
Exactly. Thank you very much. And in this respect, I can also ask another question, that do you think that UGC and government should take initiatives on this, particularly blended learning and digital or e-learning platform? They should have some initiatives. Do you think?
Yes, the MHRD through UGC, they have already taken some of the schemes, and this online and digital platform setting up of it, they have separate guidelines also for like this Directorate of Distance Education. There is also this digital platforms of Directorate of Digital Learning, and already some of the guidelines UGC has already promulgated in some 2018 or 19, I think. So it is already there. Now our higher education departments of the states, because it is in the concurrent list, so we have to ratify it in the higher education councils, then in the universities, and in the curriculum frameworks, we have to rethink about whether these digital platforms or digital learning systems should be adopted and credit transfer from the SWAM platform, or those have been developed by some other institutions, that can be given some weightage to tide over the crisis.
We also know that, thank you very much, we also know that on 26th December 2019, UGC ERO has already sent an invitation to the colleges for the giving the information regarding the credit transfer, as you said.
Yes,
UGC already has taken initiative. Out of 20 marks, a student can accommodate in his or her examination.
But unless the state government, they used to go to adopt it, otherwise it is not possible by the colleges, because that kind of autonomy is not given to the colleges. So that is the question of autonomy I was talking about.
Thank you very much, sir. And do you think that NAC, in the process of evaluation of NAC accreditation, they should have any changes in their evaluation process, like curriculum aspect and teaching learning aspect, as there are the traditional incorporation are there. So in post pandemic situation, they should change the pattern of evaluation, particularly when the ICT incorporation and ICT teaching learning method will have the more concentration.
Yes, you see, NAC, whenever comes up with the curriculum framework and the designing of the key indicators, what they do, they go design the questionnaire first, then they validate the questionnaire in the institutions. Some 50 to 100 institutions they select, they validate it. And whenever the different situation comes, so if it is a compulsion for the institutions, definitely that will be addressed in the NAC curriculum frameworks. So the key indicators will be designed in that way.
Thank you very much, sir. And another important question is there. Is COVID experience causing some universities to go bankrupt or become smaller in size and offer cheaper education? What do you think? Basically, some of our important teacher, knowledgeable teachers who does not have much more ICT knowledges, how we will go to them, or we will reach them to have gathered their expertise knowledge in our educational environment?
Yes, there are many, this question has many dimensions. The first issue is that suppose a teacher is highly knowledgeable, but he is not conversant with the digital technology. So this is not detrimental to the knowledge, actually the way that we are going to communicate. So communication is the issue. In that case, the teacher has to take the help of some of his students or maybe some other agencies, or he may go for some kind of exposure for this training. And it is not like a Hebrew. Or if a teacher can earn the knowledge, the difficult knowledges, he can understand. So it is very easy to learn some technologies very quickly. Under this compulsion of COVID, I know personally that many people from housewife to the business circle, they have learned the use of different types of apps. Now they are transacting the financial matters also. So it is not any big joke. So it is a very, very small issue, I think. If you have knowledge, discrimination cannot be hampered by this. So this can be overcome.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice presentation and the response against the questions. Now we have Dr. Indramohan Mondol, principal of Sri Chaitanya College, Habra. Sir, please, over to you. You just say something to us.
Thanks to Professor I. N. Satpathy, Director, UGC, ASRDC, University of Calcutta. And thanks to Vice Principal of Bhairav Ganguly College and Dr. S.K. Abul
Salam.
Okay, thank you. I am happy to join this session, but I am sorry for my inability to attend the first session. This seminar, one state level webinar on post pandemic teaching learning method, a paradigm shift, has been possible by the endless efforts of Bhairav Ganguly College, ICA coordinator Dr. Devabrata Das, and Dr. Dipindu Panigrahi, ICA coordinator of Sri Chaitanya College. I take much pleasure to join this state level webinar on the nice topics. It is very relevant, and I like to speak something on this, the petrifying and severe impact of COVID-19 has shaken the world to its core. Most of the governments around the world have temporarily closed the educational institution in an attempt to prevent the spread of the COVID-19 infection. Likely, the government of India, as a part of the nationwide lockdown, has closed the educational institution for the safety issue of the students and others, as a result of which learners ranging from school-going children to postgraduate students have been affected. In this situation, we are forced to communicate with the students through online and relying on digital technology to take classes on other issues. We are very hopeful that the situation will improve in the coming days and we will resume our normal work very soon, but we have to think about the matter, how we can utilize the online application parallel to classroom teaching learning method during post-pandemic period for the betterment of the student. UGC has already issued notification to all universities in the country to set curriculum which will be easily accessible through online for the benefit of students. Accordingly, UGC panel wants to start all colleges in September and issues a new calendar for universities 2020-21 session. I think undoubtedly the online method is going to be a part of our traditional education system soon. It will maintain physical distancing as the health department has already notified teachers can reach easily through digital technology to those students who are not able to attend regular classes physically due to some crisis or socioeconomic backwardness. It will solve the attendance problem. Remedial teaching through online may be conducted. It is happening. Sometimes teachers are not available in classroom teaching due to his or her management engagement in academic related issues or personal inconveniences. In this situation, both teachers and students are to face a lot of pressure to complete syllabus in time. Online classes may be better option in this situation. Besides that, conference, seminars, meetings, etc. may be held easily with inter-colleges or inter-universities through digital technology for exchange of thoughts and to reduce the financial burden of the institution. We should remember an important point that a large portion of our students coming from marginalized section of our society may not have the access to the digital technology due to economic condition and poor network issue. So I request the government and policymakers and the higher authorities from village level to state level to look after the matter for the benefit of learners and the mass and their parents as well. Thank you.
Feedback already.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice speech. Now, Dr. Sarpati sir, Dr. Pranab Kumar Das from our audience, he is now a question to you, sir.
Okay.
If artificial intelligence mixes with online teaching tools, what would be the future of a physical classroom and teacher?
Okay, this is a very interesting question. That man has created God. Similarly, artificial intelligence has been created by man. So artificial intelligence shall never substitute human intelligence. And if that happens, then definitely we are not going to see human civilization. That will be a civilization of artificial intelligence. So long it is a human civilization, we are there and we are going to stay there. Many of the jobs which are skill-based, that will suffer a lot. But teachers are safer. So good teachers were in demand, they are in demand, and they will be in demand. So teachers cannot be substituted. Teachers make all professionals. So we the teachers have to retrain ourselves, rethink ourselves, how to improvise in the coming days. So that is our big challenge.
Exactly. Nice to take your question, sir. And I would like to provide some information to the live audiences. We have keep the feedback form link in our YouTube chat box. So if it is not worked, kindly copy and paste it to your browser. Then put your feedback to validate our webinar and to provide the better services in the next future to you. Now I would like to go to Dr. Sanjit Kumar Das to conclude the webinar session. Dr. Das.
Thank you, Dr. Salam. In this valedictory session, first of all, I express my heartiest thanks to all the participants in this webinar. Hope you have enjoyed and enriched by the presentation of our respected resource persons, Dr. Manoj Poidu and Dr. Lakshmi Narayan Satpathy. I express my heartiest thanks to both of them for their presentation. Dr. Poidu mainly focused on the use of the different apps in the classrooms, teaching, examination and evaluation system on online mode. He vividly discussed on the techniques that would be helpful in the transformation phase for all the teachers in coping with the solutions. And Professor Satpathy mainly focused on the academic and administrative steps that are necessary to counter the challenges we are facing sir has focused on the adaptability of the new generation, how they could be adjusted with the new phenomena of this post-COVID situation. And now I would conclude the webinar. Before that, I would like to mention that since long, teachers have has been considered as the most respectable person in the society because of their dedication for nurturing and guiding the teenagers in shaping them ideally suited for the society. And in this situation, also, we have to render our responsibility towards the society by preparing them through online mode, considering the social distancing issues. Probably it will take few years or months to normalize the situation, but the online system is reality, basically the reality in near future, and will continue forever. So I request all of you to shape yourself with your changing needs of time in the academic arena. Finally, I conclude the webinar by expressing my heartiest thanks to Dr. Abul Salam for his technical support throughout the day in successful completion of this webinar. And I also thank the coordinators and members of all the college, two colleges, the Bhairavamuni College and Sri Chaitanya College. And finally, Sep, please stay home, please stay safe, and enjoy the days. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. We conclude the day. Thank you.